We're going to focus on the control unit that Vintage Era puts with the system.
This week on Auto RestoMod, Jeff puts the control panel for the Vintage Air AC unit together. Be sure to like and subscribe for more great videos on classic car mods and restorations.
National Parts Depot offers quality restoration parts for Mustang, Cougar, Camaro, Firebird, Chevelle, GTO, Chevy and Ford trucks, Bronco and Thunderbird. For quality parts in stock and delivered fast from our four warehouses nationwide, nobody beats NPD's speed and service. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free. NPD, make your dream happen.
Well, here's what we got. I have basically decided to break the interior episode into two parts. This week we're going to focus on the control unit that Vintage Era puts with the system and build that out. And then next week we'll go into doing the install of the central HVAC unit, and then the week after that we'll finalize it with hoses and everything else, because I'm trying desperately off camera to get the entire system put together as far as the wiring is concerned, so that we can start the truck and then run the system so that you can see how well it cools in our local 50 degree weather. It was really nice for a few days, and then it's gone back in the toilet, and we're doing like 30s in the morning and 50s during the day. So I'm hoping that by the time we get to that this coming weekend for our shooting, things will be a little bit better and we won't have that issue. But what we're going to talk about right now is building the control head for the AC system from Vintage Air. And then next week we'll be going on into the rest of the interior components, because there is quite a lot to talk about in both areas. So, without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and get over to the tabletop and get busy on this. All right, because we had the all the instrument cluster and everything already out of the vehicle, because we were doing a wiring harness install on it, I already had this stuff out. But basically what you have to do is you have to take this piece, and there is access through the glove box opening to get to this nut. And then the other one with all the cables and everything in the way is a little harder to get to, but you can get to it through the same area. And it's just on the other side over by the ashtray. These can be kind of a pain to pull out, just simply because this one especially doesn't have a lot of working room for you to take it out of there. The cool thing about this system from the guys at Vintage Air is all of this pretty much goes away. You lose the original arms, the original switch comes out, and they actually give you a really cool rheostat so that you're not going click, click, click to change your fan position. It's actually a variable speed. Your faceplate, it goes away as well. Ours was worn out. I don't miss it already. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to finish pulling this apart. I'm going to set the bezel aside, and I'm going to basically take the only piece from this that we are retaining, which is this aluminum piece right here, off of the bezel itself. It has 2/4-inch screws inside of the mounting box. This is basically just your light chamber for the AC panel itself. After we get through bead blasting this, we're going to go in and just build the entire system. All right, take my light off the back side, drop my bolt there, self-tapping screw. I'm going to take this over to my bead blast cabinet, and I'm going to bead blast it, and then it'll be nice and shiny to go along with the nice and shiny parts we got from Vintage Air. All right, back from bead blasting. This is that piece. I've cleaned it up. Yes, I probably could have cleaned it with some Windex or whatever, but I just like playing with the bead blaster. So there it is. It's all done. Now, this is a little out of order, but I wanted to show you how nice this is. This is the piece that comes with the switch panel kit for 1968 to 72 Ford pickup trucks. 1967 was a little bit of a squirrel. They did things a little differently, so I'm not sure what your kit would include with that, because this is what we're working on as a 72, so this kit would be the one for it. But this is the switching panel. This basically just sits on here like this, fits nicely, and when you lift it up and turn it over, you have a nice looking clean install. I like the way it looks. They even went to the trouble of actually using a very similar font to what Ford used back in the day. So overall, I give these guys an A++ on this part right here. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull these two pieces aside for a minute and get into the fiddly stuff, because the fiddly stuff is starting to do with this piece, which is what bolts up to the back of the this panel here. Now, you've got a rheostat which comes with it. The rheostat has the nut and washer assembly. And you'll want to take and install your rheostat like so. Now there is a locating pin. You can see it goes straight into the bracket here. And you'll want to hold this in position and you'll put your washer on. Then you'll put the nut on. I know, I'm high-teching it here. But I don't need to gorilla this thing in here, but you want it nice and tight. I'm gonna take my socket and just final tighten it up, holding it in position so it doesn't spin out, because that can actually bust that tab off if you're not careful with it. That should be good. Next up, you'll install this washer. The washer is a nylon washer, and this goes on here. And then your switch, basically this just looks like a factory style. You can even use the original style ends on this, and the push-on style that has the set screws in them. This goes in like this. I'm going to set that down because I'm going to make a little point here. You have three different styles of locking Nylock nuts for this. These two are not for this particular part of the application. The short Nylock has the correct thread pitch. It's actually a little shorter than the other two. And you want to use that and put that on here as well. It's a Nylock, so you're going to have to tighten it with a wrench. You don't want to go too far because you want it to have motion room in it. So you kind of want to play with the position a little bit. You want it a little bit looser. I don't want it so loose that it feels like it's trying to fall off of there. The Nylock's going to keep it in place. All right, from there, I move on to the side set screw. All right, you've got a 3/8 inch screw that goes through the hole here. You'll probably want to get a screwdriver to kind of make it go through because it is a little tight because of the chrome probably. First time you run it through there though, you should be pretty good. Now, there is a small nylon washer and a larger nylon washer. You are not using the larger nylon washer on this portion of it. You'll put your small nylon washer on. All right, now when you're going to install the actuator arm, which is this piece here, you have two different sizes again on these offset washers. And you'll want the smaller one. The larger one goes back in your pile, and you'll want the smallest Nylock nut. This is 1/4 inch in size. You'll want to install the arm onto here. Not completely, so that it slides over it like that. Then you'll install the Nylock. And then you'll put your nut on here. There's just enough room to get the screw on there, and then you can install this and just kind of work it through its range of motion to see how it runs. You don't want it too loose, but you don't want it so tight that it is hard to operate. So you'll kind of play with this a little bit. You'll kind of play with this a little bit to make sure you're in good shape with it. I'm liking that real well. All right, last but not least, on the fan control, you have a D-ring that goes on here that I think is basically just to keep that little booger right where it needs to be. Not really any other function for that. So that is all operating nicely. Now we're going to move on to the actual actuator arms for your blend doors and for your temperature. Your arm on the top needs to mount this way with the screw going through it. You have a nylon washer that goes between the screw and the arm itself. And it goes in the back hole here, and this all faces toward the direction of your fan control. Then you have a larger nylon washer that goes underneath here to give you the motion you need in that. And then this inserts through here. And it's kind of the same thing as I've talked about before. You'll probably want to get a screwdriver to push it down through there. You can just screw it in. I like that the tolerances on this are really tight. That's a good thing in my opinion. Once you get it in the bottom of it, you can just overscrew it and you'll hear it break through that coating that they've got on there. I don't know if it's a powder coating or a paint, but whatever it is, that's holding it a little bit. And then you'll put this on the back side, screw it down until it hits the nylon. You have the larger 3/8 inch screw. You'll do the same thing with this one that you did before. We'll get a screwdriver on one side of it. And you'll get your wrench on the other side of it. And you'll tighten it down until it reaches a good tension so that it's not super loose, but it's not so tight that the arm won't go through its range of motion. That's actually pretty good. I'm happy with that. So now I'm going to move on to the actual other control arm and go ahead and install it. In the instructions, they recommend that you go ahead and hook up the motors here for this. I'm not going to do that because I want to go ahead and get the arms completely installed before I move on to this assembly. So I'm going to wait and do this next after I get the other arm installed. And it's basically the same as this one. All right, I'm going to install the other arm. It goes in the same direction as the actuator for all the different controls. This is actually your temperature control, and it goes through not the back hole here, but the front hole. And you'll want to put your washer on the screw, the small washer, like this. And then you'll take the arm and install the screw in the arm. You'll put the fat washer on here, and you'll put that down through the hole in the bracket here. And this is not one to play nice with others, so we're going to have to go in and just screw that down. But the bracketry is built in such a way that you can get to it, so that's really nice. Makes installation a lot easier for these parts. And same thing, you're going to go in and just tighten it up so it's got tension on it, but it's not so tight that you can't move it. All right, now I've already assembled the mode control. This is the one that controls all of your temperature stuff, changing from AC to defrost to heat. And this one is all completely put together. And I'm going to show you how to assemble these on the other one, but what I wanted to go over was this. On the mode control, which is the bracket that sticks up in the air, that's kind of an independent piece on the back side, the mode control actually goes in port 3 for controlling the system on here. And you'll want to get it set up so that it's kind of like this, and you'll notice that it does bend these shafts. That's okay. That's part of the deal on this. And it only goes so far in any case, so you're not going to be able to bend it over too much. But that one is set up and operating the way it should be operating. Now I'm going to flip this thing over and show you the actual installation procedure for the other one. All right, now on the temperature control, you won't be going with the third hole. You actually use the second hole. So what you'll want to do is you'll want to split this off of here and break it out. Now, if you're doing something on a different vehicle, it breaks out at different points. It just depends on which vehicle you're working on. All right, now this one installs like the other one. The installs, both of them are face up. And this will be worked out in just a second. But the big thing you want to know is when you're installing these, you have these speed screws. And I really recommend pre-installing the speed screws, because if you don't, it'll be a lot more work because of the spring clips that Vintage Air uses to set these up. I'm just going to get this thing to thread in. And believe me, this will make your job a lot easier whenever you're going in and putting the actual system together. Get that out of the way. On the brackets, they have a tab that sticks out. The shoulder of the actual actuator itself, the mode control as they like to call it, actually sits right here. It slides into that bracket to that point right there. You have a spring clip that goes on here. These spring clips clamp over pretty quickly, so you want to kind of get this in the position that you need it in before you start tightening everything down. And it's really kind of hard to do this, honestly, because you have to get the spring clip set. You have to get this in the correct position. Hold your mouth just right. And now you know why I wanted you to start that speed screw first. Before you tighten everything down completely, make sure your actuator arm is in the correct position. It looks like we're good to go. We're up against the bracket there. And now I'm going to final tighten this one down and then show you the procedure on the rest of it. Okay, that's sitting flat now. Now you have the washer that goes on the back side of it. Just like on the other one, it won't quite completely install. Then you have your screw that comes up from the underneath here, threads into the hole on the arm. Then you have a nylock that goes in on the back side of it. And you'll want to try to move it so that you can get to it with your screwdriver. And you'll have a 1/4-inch drive. And drive that thing home. Again, you don't want to over tighten it so that you got good motion in the arm itself. Looks like we're good to go on that. So now those two are set where they need to be. Now all we got left to do is to install all of this onto the actual faceplate, and more importantly, the backing plate here. And you'll use your original fasteners to put those back in position. All right, now I'm going to install the light box onto here. I'm going to get my 1/4 drive out and get it ready to install. And these just go back into the factory locations in the light box. Like I said before, this is a pretty brilliant idea in my opinion. Now they go in and they actually don't use a self-tapping. They have you put a serrated nut on either side. I have to get on that with something else. Always helps when I make faces when I'm working on this stuff. Okay, and I'm going to go in and just final tighten those up in a second. But then this installs on here. Blades go through. And there you have it. All right, now you have a green with white wire that plugs into your fan switch, which that's right here. And this actually plugs in over the top. This. And then they want you to go in and put a zip tie, a tiny, tiny zip tie on the switch right here. Cut that off. Then you have to wire up the mode and temperatures. What I'll say about this is I will always mark this for mode. That way I don't have to sit here and try to put everything back together real quickly to see where I'm at. And when you do this, then you'll want to go in and have your yellow with white wire plug into the mode control. And I'm always a little scared of these because they use a tiny pin system on them. Then they want you to take and bend these over. And I'm going to show you this on the other one because it'll just be a little easier to see. But the same thing with the zip ties. Zip tie it down right up against here and you fold those wires over. And clip them off. And then the red with white goes into the other controller here. Pick it up again and roll it over to make it a little easier for me to see where we're going in the holes at. A little bit better on that one than I did on the other one. Now this one on the Ford truck setup is not used, so you'll just want to take and tie that off back into the harness. I'm not going to do anything with it yet because I want to get this whole harness assembly laid into the truck and then I'll figure out where I want to tie this thing off at. Typically what I'll do is I'll just bring it back here and I'll tie wrap it out of the way. I'm going to use a couple of the other tie wraps to tie these things down a little further back down the line here. And then this assembly is ready to go back in the truck. I'll show you how it goes in the truck in just a second. All right, I'm going to install this into the dash panel. This piece will need to feed around to the back side of it, and I usually will just go through the glove box on these installs. It's just easier. And this will sit in right up underneath the ashtray. And let me get the other piece in here now. Probably gonna have a hard time seeing this, possibly. If you have the radio in here, it's a lot harder to do this. I recommend pulling the radio out. It's easier install. All right, now I'm gonna close the glove box door. Now this will give you an idea how this is gonna look inside the truck once it's all completed and installed. I really like the way this thing lays in. Everything's pretty well thought out on this. I like the setup and how they ran everything, how all the tie-ins are done. Nicely done. We still have the rest of the box to mount in here, but that's coming on here in just a little bit. I want to get this out of the way because it's just one piece that we can kind of throw in here so that we're not having to deal with it at a later time. Well, that's it. That's the AC control put into the F100. I really like the amount of detail that Vintage Air went to on this piece in order to make it work. The control head that was in there originally for not just the AC system, but the original heater systems was very convoluted. It was very cable heavy, and it was a pain in the butt to try to get everything to work right. I tried getting the original heat system to work in this truck back in the day when I first got this thing. I was just gonna leave it without an AC system in it. There were cables that were missing. The ones that were there weren't operating correctly. It was a hot mess. And it was expensive too, because the bellows system that goes from the actual AC box to the outside vent on the side of the truck was pretty pricey. And when you go in and have to rebuild all the cabling and all that other stuff, it just starts adding up. Is it as expensive as doing an AC system in a car? No. It is not, but it doesn't provide cold air. And believe me, in South Carolina where I live, in the summertime when it's 100 degrees during the day and the relative humidity is enough that you almost need an aqualung to breathe, you get the idea. Well, that's our show for this week, folks. Be sure to come back and watch us next time on Auto Resto Mod. You guys have a great week. We'll see you later. Entertaining, but I do.